In advocating for low-density living, people often contrast their peaceful suburbs and quiet small towns with the crowds and chaos of downtown, especially if they live close to a big city with a major central business district that's a regional destination. In this video, we want to propose that people from outside of cities tend to have a skewed perception of urban living and density, because their experience with city life is mostly with downtown in the most literal sense. When they go to the city, they're commuting to a job in the financial district, or they're going to an event at a downtown stadium or convention center, typically with lots of other suburbanites and out-of-towners. They're generally not visiting the countless dense residential neighborhoods outside of downtown, where most urbanites actually live and spend most of their time. The disproportionate amount of space taken by the central business district in people's perception of city life is something we've seen from other people, but also experienced ourselves. We both grew up well outside of cities, and for quite a few years didn't have a great sense of what it was actually like to live in one. When I first moved to Toronto for grad school, I talked to someone about an apartment opportunity in a house, and I remember asking them whether they could see the CN Tower from their street. They found that funny, because the CN Tower is just not something they think about on a daily basis. But the downtown landmarks were such a big part of my perception of the city. After moving to a different apartment nearby, I realized just how much downtown actually feels like a different world, even though it was still kind of cool that you could sometimes see the CN Tower. And this was near the University of Toronto, which is only 2 or 3 kilometers from downtown. There are lots of other dense urban neighborhoods further away that feel even more removed from downtown.
We actually understand the aversion that many people have to downtown living. In both Toronto and Montreal, we often went downtown for things we needed or just to explore, but it wouldn't be our first choice for where to wake up every day. Many people enjoyed the unparalleled convenience, but we find it can be overwhelming when you combine the residents, commuters, tourists, and other visitors, including people coming to the central city just to be loud and express their views, like protesters and preachers. There also usually isn't as much quiet, calming space immediately accessible, whether quiet streets or parks. Canadian downtowns don't have the associations with violence that many central cities in the US have, but property crime can be an issue, and it's probably not a coincidence that the year we lived on the edge of downtown Toronto was the year one of our bikes got chopped up and stolen. It might seem funny that the people behind an urbanism channel aren't big proponents of quote-unquote downtown living, but the part of the city we're talking about, with the biggest concentration of residential density, office towers, and attractions for tourists and visitors, is actually pretty small. That's not what city life is for most people. You can live 2 or 3 kilometers away, sometimes even less, and have an entirely different experience. The two neighborhoods we have the most experience with, the Annex and Harvard Village area in Toronto, and the Plateau in Montreal, are good examples, but we could list dozens of other comparable neighborhoods, like the Golden Triangle in Ottawa and the West End in Vancouver. All of these areas are quite dense, housing 4 to 8 times more people than a typical suburban neighborhood.
But to focus on the Plateau and the Annex, where we have the most experience living, neither of these neighborhoods felt crowded, noisy, and overwhelming, in the way that the two cities' downtowns sometimes did. Both had lively commercial streets with bars, restaurants, and shops, and these could definitely get busy at times. But they were also balanced out by so many quiet residential streets that you could easily walk to or live on if you prefer. In both neighborhoods, we lived on residential streets 200 or 300 meters from the main commercial streets, and basically did not encounter noise or commotion problems at all. Well, until the Montreal Canadiens made it to the Stanley Cup Finals, and the entire city of Montreal went absolutely crazy, and a nearby apartment got gutted from a fire. Okay, that doesn't sound great, but you have to give Montreal some leeway for hockey. Aside from that, our experience living in these dense urban neighborhoods was remarkably calm and peaceful, no less so than in the suburbs. In some ways, there was more peace and quiet, because suburban areas have their own noise issues, like large dogs, loud machinery like lawnmowers and leaf blowers, and the bigger, noisier cars and trucks that are more common in the suburbs.
We've said that we prefer the environment of a dense residential neighborhood over downtown, which raises the question of whether that's a good reason to block new development in these neighborhoods, to cap density and avoid becoming downtown. The Annex in Toronto is always in the news trying to block development. Is that legitimate? They'll note that they're already fairly dense, which is true, at least by suburban standards. But they have a very long way to go before they become downtown. And they're less dense than Montreal neighborhoods that we also find very calm. On top of this, downtown is far more than just residential density. Unless you have the big amenities that draw people in from all over the region in the middle of your neighborhood, like stadiums and shopping malls and office towers, it's pretty unlikely that you'll end up with the same level of commotion. Even small-scale amenities won't do that. We had a cafe, bookstore, small grocery store, and music conservatory in the middle of our residential neighborhood in Montreal, and it was pretty sweet.
Finally, a big part of the commotion of downtown is all the cars driving through. Substantial car traffic adds stress and commotion to a place like almost nothing else, especially if there's honking. If a neighborhood minimizes that with traffic calming and pedestrian streets, and they prioritize accessibility through walking, cycling, and transit instead, they can house a lot more people while still providing a calm and relaxing environment. Changes like that could also be used to make actual downtown a more calming and relaxing place, even with large numbers of people, although that's a different video.
Obviously, not everyone has the same preferences and tolerances as us. Some people thrive in a bustling downtown environment, and other people want nothing more than to live in the middle of the woods far from anyone else. We just want to point out that a lot of people from outside the city, including us at one point, don't really know what it's like to live in a dense urban neighborhood, because their main experience with a bigger, denser city is as a visitor, maybe coming in on a crowded highway and having trouble finding parking, then going to the downtown attractions at the same time as lots of other commuters, suburbanites, and visitors. These things are part of city life. Urbanites often go to these events too, but it's just one small slice of city life. Something really gets lost when we debate downtown living compared to suburban or small town living, because there's a wide range of possibilities in between. Thanks for watching through to the end of the video. Don't forget that dense living comes in many forms, and subscribe. A special thanks goes out to our supporters on Patreon.